Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship. Nice to see all of you here today. Having seen the light of the gospel, having seen God's forgiveness, we can't help but share that wonderful news with others. Sure, there are times when we feel afraid, when we come up with excuses after excuse, just like Moses did when he was nervous about sharing God's word, but God's love for us compels us. It moves us to let our light of faith shine. And it's that truth we're going to celebrate here today. We ask God for encouragement from his word as well. We'll begin our worship with our opening hymn, Rise, Shine, You People. And we can't sing this hymn sitting down, so I'm going to invite you to please stand up. And may God bless our worship here today. The Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples. But the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Jesus Christ is the light of the world, the light no darkness can overcome. Amen. Dear friends, let us approach God with a true heart and confess our sins, asking him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to forgive us.
Lord of life, I confess that I am by nature dead in sin, for a faithless worry and selfish pride, for sins of habit and sins of choice, for the evil I have done and the good I have failed to do. You should cast me away from your presence forever. O Lord, I am sorry for my sins. Forgive me for Jesus' sake.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In his great mercy, God made us alive in Christ, even when we were dead in our sins. Hear the word of Christ through his called servant. I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the well-being of all people everywhere, that they may receive from you all they need to sustain body and life, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the spread of your life-giving gospel throughout the world, that all who are lost in sin may be brought to faith in you, hear our prayer, O Christ.
Christ, have mercy.
for patience and perseverance in this life, that we may not lose the hope of heaven as we await your return. Hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord of life, live in us that we may live for you.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord.
Lord, your holy word was sung a hidden treasure, till to its place it was by grace restored in fullest measure. For this today our thanks we say and gladly glorify you. Your mercy show and grace bestow on all who still deny you. Since you are mine, my Lord divine, that holds no dreadful terrors, your precious blood, my highest good, has blotted out my errors. My thanks to you, your word is true, fulfill your promise ever. And mercy give while here I live, and heavenly bliss forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, you know that we are surrounded by many dangers and that we often stumble and fall. Strengthen us in body and mind and bring us safely through all temptations. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
In our first scripture reading this morning, we see how God encourages Jeremiah to fearlessly and continuously spread the word of God. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." "Ah, sovereign Lord," I said, "I do not know how to speak. I am only a child." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say, 'I am only a child.' You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you," declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, "Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms, to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. This is the word of the Lord." I invite you in singing the refrain of "Thy Word is the Lamp."
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. And nothing will I fear, as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget
your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Oh, Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side, and I will love you to the end.
My word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. My word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Paul writes in Romans chapter 10 that even with the rejection of God's word by his own people, he did not stop teaching and preaching this message of grace to everyone. We read, "But I ask, did they not hear? Of course they did. Their voice has gone out into all the earth, their words to the ends of the world. Again I ask, did Israel not understand? First Moses says, I will make you envious by those who are not a nation. I will make you angry by a nation that has no understanding. And Isaiah boldly says, I was found by those who did not seek me. I revealed myself to those who did not ask for me. But concerning Israel, he says, all day long I have held out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people. I ask then, did God reject his people? By no means. I am an Israelite myself, a descendant of Abraham from the tribe of Benjamin. God did not reject his people, whom he foreknew. Don't you know that what the scripture says in the passage about Elijah, how he appealed to God against Israel? Lord, they have killed your prophets and torn down your altars. I am the only one left, and they are trying to kill me. And what was God's answer to him? I have reserved for myself 7,000 who have not bowed the knee to Baal. So too, at the present time, there is a remnant chosen by grace. And if by grace, then it is no longer by works. If it were, grace would no longer be grace. This is the word of the Lord. We join in singing the verse of the day.
The Lord's own spirit is on me. My mouth proclaims the king's decree. The poor are blessed, the prisoners free. And all the blind the light now see.
Please rise for the reading of the gospel. Luke records for us how the people in the synagogue rejected Jesus and the word of God, but that this rejection did not stop Jesus from teaching and preaching the word of God. We read, "Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began by saying to them, 'Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing.' All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. 'Isn't this Joseph's son?' they asked. Jesus said to them, 'Surely you will quote this proverb to me, "Physician, heal yourself. Do here in your hometown what we have heard that you did in Capernaum." I tell you the truth,' he continued, 'no prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years and there was a severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian.' All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built, in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. Then he went down to Capernaum, a town in Galilee, and on the Sabbath began to teach to the people. They were amazed at his teaching, because his message had authority." This is the gospel of the Lord. You may be seated.
This time I invite the children to come forward for the children's message. Thank you. right on up here, guys. Grab a seat. Squish in. Come on, over here. Right over here. Right over here.
There you go. How are you guys doing today?
Good.
Good. I got a question for you. Are you guys scared of anything?
Whoa. Brave group.
You're not scared of anything? Anybody scared of spiders?
No.
Anybody scared of bears?
I've never seen one.
Oh, you've never seen one. Anybody, you're just permanently scared? Are you scared? Anybody scared of the dark? Anybody sleep with the nightlight?
Yes, I
sleep with the nightlight. You do, yeah! Yeah, that happens sometimes. Yeah. You know, why do we sleep with a nightlight sometimes?
So we can see in the dark.
So we can see in the dark. Because sometimes being in the dark is scary, isn't it? Yeah, when it's nighttime.
And my cousin sleeps very good.
Oh, good. Good. That can be scary when it's in the dark sometimes, when we feel like we're alone. But that's why we have a nightlight on. You know, God gives us something to make us feel better. Really? Wow. That's great. That's awesome. God gives us a light to give us. He gives us some comfort. He gives us something to take care of us. And when he's... That's awesome. And what we do, God gives us something to make us comforted. He gives us something to make sure that we're not scared. And he's given us the Bible to do that. And the Bible tells us something very, 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 very comforting. The Bible tells us about Jesus. What does Jesus do for us that comforts us? What did he do? He took our sins away. That's right. Jesus took all of your sins away by dying on the cross and paying for them. So that way, that's right, he took your sins away. He took your sins away and my sins away, everybody's sins away, so we get to go to heaven someday and be with him. Let's thank him for giving us this comfort, okay? Let's fold our hands and let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for showing me the light of your word and letting me know that my sins are forgiven and that I don't need to be afraid of them. Thank you, Jesus, for your comfort and your amazing love. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, you guys can go back and sit with your parents, or you can go back with Miss Shauna for Kids Church, okay? Good job. That was nice talking with you. And we'll continue with our hymn of the day, Speak, O Lord.
Of your pure
Scars our faith to rise, scars our eyes to see your majestic love and the foreign sea. Words of power that can never fail, let their truth prevail over
and peace are yours in abundance through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The words for our meditation here this morning are taken from Jeremiah chapter 1, which you heard read earlier. Please bow your heads for prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Dear brothers and sisters, in the portion of God's word before us this morning, we see an amazing account of God's love and God's power. He calls the prophet Jeremiah into service. And in this account, you know what? I get to do this week after week. Almost every single day, I get to share God's word with somebody else. You know, Stephen, you're up. I'm just going to take a break, okay? You take the sermon this morning.
You want me to do it off the cuff?
Obviously, you know I'm joking. But what if I was being serious? What do you think, RT? Eli, what would you say? How would you react? How would you feel about that? Anything?
Unprepared.
I'm not prepared. I don't know what I would say. I'm scared of speaking in front of large groups of people. I'd be nervous. You know that's why pastors wear the white robe, so you can't see my knees knocking. I'm just a kid. Ah, sovereign Lord, I'm only a child. That's what Jeremiah says in the lesson before us when God called him into service. Sovereign Lord, I'm only a child. When you understand Jeremiah a little bit, and when you understand the ministry to which God called him, his hesitation is pretty understandable. We can sympathize with Jeremiah. He was a young guy. Maybe a little bit older than you, Stephen, in his teens, early 20s, when God called him to be a prophet. Now, our pastors, when they come fresh out of the seminary, are typically in their mid-20s when they pop into the pulpits. But at that day, that time, that culture, no one really cared. No one really gave too much respect to what you thought or what you had to say until you were at least about 30 years old. So Jeremiah knows this. Lord, who am I? I'm only a child. Why would anyone listen to me? If they wouldn't listen to men like Moses or prophets like Elijah, what makes you think they're going to listen to little old me? Sovereign Lord, I can't do this. I'm only a child. When you understand Jeremiah's personality, it also helps us understand his hesitation. Anybody know what Jeremiah's nickname is? The Weeping Prophet. The Weeping Prophet. Now, wasn't that Jeremiah got all teary-eyed every time he saw a beautiful sunset or when he saw a kitty? It wasn't that he was a wimp or a mama's boy, but Jeremiah was a very tender-hearted man. He loved people. He loved people, and it killed him when he saw his fellow townsmen, his fellow countrymen, straying from God's will and God's way. It tore him apart. Sovereign Lord, I can't do this. Don't you want someone a little tougher? You're about to send me into a real battle here with some hostile people. This message isn't going to be popular. I don't know if I can stand up underneath this pressure and this strain. I don't know if I can have all these days of sadness over and over again. Sovereign Lord, I'm only a child. I can't do this. The audience to whom he was preaching, the people to whom he would minister, at the time, a lot of Israel's religious leaders, their kings, their prophets, their priests, were telling everybody, things are great, all's well. Anybody remember what was coming? What was about to happen? Captivity. Babylon was going to sweep in from the east, cart people off into slavery, cart them away from their homeland. Destruction was coming. Pain, strife. And God wanted the people to know that. He wanted them to know that they needed to repent, that they needed to prepare their hearts. And he says, here, Jeremiah, this is the message that I want you to preach, even though everybody else is saying something else, a little bit more popular, a little bit more what people want to hear. Here, Jeremiah. You know what the kicker was? That a lot of those religious leaders, you know who they were? Jeremiah's family. Now, some of you know how uncomfortable that can be, confronting a parent or maybe an older sibling when you're telling them what they're doing is going against God's word, that what they're doing is sin. Some of you know how uncomfortable that can be. Almost all of us know what it's like to be the bearer of bad news. How would you like to do that for the rest of your life? How would you like to sign up for Jeremiah's job? Any takers? Sovereign Lord, I'm only a child. I can't do this. You know, Jeremiah's gut reaction about how people would feel about him wasn't too far off. If you read later on the story of his life, you find out that people from his own hometown, people from his own family, participated in plots to try and shut him up, plots to try and have him killed. Sovereign Lord, I'm only a child. I can't do this. I'm not up for this. Sisters and brothers, God has called all of us, not just pastors, but all of us, to participate in this ministry. It is all of our privilege and responsibility, our joy, to proclaim not just the good news, not just the gospel, but also his law. Have you ever felt like Jeremiah? You know, Stephen, RT, I'm just a kid. I'm just a child. I wouldn't know what to say. Who would listen to what I have to say? I don't know how to speak. I don't feel comfortable with it. I'm just a child. You've probably had other fears, though, too, when it comes to this calling that God has given to each and every one of his children. God, how can I tell the kids that I go to school with that what they're doing with their boyfriends, what they're doing with their girlfriends is wrong? When I find myself tripping into temptation and struggling with sin. God, how can I tell my children about the do's and don'ts of drug and alcohol abuse when I did a lot of those things when I was their age? Won't they look at me as if I'm just a hypocrite? God, how can I assure someone that, you know, you have a plan, that your way is always right, and that they can trust in you when I'm really struggling to see what that plan is. God, how can I promise someone that you're always with them, that you will never leave them, you will never forsake them, you'll never abandon them, but you'll always stay by their side? How can I tell someone with a straight face when I feel so alone? We examine our hearts, examine our lives, we feel a lot like Jeremiah did. Oh, Sovereign Lord, I'm only a child. Who am I? I'm a fragile, sinful man. Who am I? My sins, my fears, my doubts, it's Exhibit A, Exhibit B, Exhibit C in this case against me. Its evidence is indisputable. I'm not up for something like that. I'm not up for this responsibility, this calling. All of those are a blood-curdling scream that I'm anything but a vessel for God, right? But our Father in heaven, as Paul says to the Romans, calls things that are not as though they were. The Lord, the God of free and faithful grace, said to Jeremiah, "Do not say, I am only a child. Don't tell me that you can't do this." Was God denying Jeremiah's youth? Wasn't his youth something that would work against him in this ministry? Don't our faults, our failures, our inadequacies, don't they work against us when we try to share God's word? Does God just ignore them? He ignore our sins? No. Let's see what the Lord said to Jeremiah. "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." Jeremiah, in eternity, I've had this plan for you. Do not say, I am only a child. You are my child, Jeremiah. And I've worked this all out. I've put this plan into place, I've set things in order, and I have called you here to this time, to this place, to this ministry to accomplish my work. And I don't make mistakes. Why do you say, I don't know how to speak? Why do you worry about what you'll say, Jeremiah? You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. These are my words. This is my will. This is my way, not your own. If it were up to you, Jeremiah, if it was up to your own thoughts, yes, you'd fail and people could have something to say. But this is what I, the Lord, the God of heaven and earth, have to say. Jeremiah records, "Then the Lord reached out his hand, touched my mouth, and said to me, 'Now I have put my words in your mouth.' See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant." What a wonderful promise to a young man who was shaking in his sandals. Don't worry, my son, about what you are supposed to say. Don't worry about where you're supposed to go. Don't worry about to whom you're supposed to preach. I will show you. I will be with you. I have put my words in your mouth. Jeremiah, I realize that this ministry isn't going to be easy. I'm not going to lie to you and say that you won't face some hostile hearts. I'm not going to lie and tell you that your life won't be threatened. I'm not going to lie and tell you that you won't lose friends. But Jeremiah, do not be afraid. For I am with you and will rescue you. Jeremiah, are you only a child? Absolutely. But you're my child. Mine. Sovereign Lord, I am only a sinful man. I'm only a fragile, frail human being. I'm only a child. But God says, well, what you say is true. So is this. You are mine. God says that to you. For the creation of the universe, I had you in mind. I was the one who knit you in your mother's womb. I know you through and through. I know the fears, the doubts that you have in your heart. But I love you. I know so much about you. I know more than you know about yourself. I know the number of hairs that are on your head. I've known you and I've loved you, and I did something about your problem of sin, your inadequacies, your failures, your faults. I sent you my son. He's the one who took on flesh for you. He's the one who shed his blood for you so that all those sins, those doubts, those fears could be washed away. Yes, you are only a child, but you are God's child. And now he's sending you out into the path he's laid out before you to share the news of his patience and his mercy. As Paul said to the Ephesians, for we, all of us, we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Still the same Lord, same God, who guides you and directs you and places opportunity after opportunity for you to share the news of the security, of the peace that you have with him, now and into eternity. The same God who says to you, I will not fail you, I will not leave you, I'll give you the words to say. I know it's going to be difficult, I know you're going to face some heat, some hostility from maybe even members of your own family, but do not be afraid. I am with you. I'm with you right now. Sounds great and all, but how can we be sure it's true? Because it's the same Lord, the God who makes promises and keeps promises, who touched our hearts with the gospel, who washed us in the waters of our baptism, who feeds us day after day with his word and week after week at his meal. It's the same God who's changed our lives. Fellow children of God, as we stand on the beginning of another week, we leave those failures, we leave those fears, those doubts, those sins at Christ's cross. Because there, he paid for them. There, he died for them. But since he rose from the grave, we can be assured that those are dead and gone. That's a part of our past. And as we walk out the doors later on this afternoon, and as we enter into that path that God has placed before us, there is going to be opportunity after opportunity for you to share your faith, for you to let this hope that you've seen here and celebrated here today be shown to another. That's not a coincidence. That's not just by chance. That is God giving you an opportunity. God calling you to be his vessel. May he fill our lives with those opportunities. May he fill our hearts with encouragement. And may he bless our lips as we speak the story of salvation. Are you only a child? Yes. But you are God's child. Amen. Please stand. May the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. We join in our confession of faith found on page 10 in our worship folder. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. What does this mean? I believe that I cannot, by my own thinking or choosing, believe in Jesus Christ, my Lord, or come to him. But the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, sanctified and kept me in the true faith.
In the same way, he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth, and keeps it with Jesus Christ in the one true faith. In this Christian church, he daily and fully forgives all sins to me and all believers. On the last day, he will raise me and all the dead, and give eternal life to me and all believers in Christ. This is most certainly true.
Please be seated. At this time, our ushers are going to be handing out our friendship registers, so please be sure to fill those out to mark your visit here with us today, so we can thank you for joining us for worship. Also, those of you who are joining us online, please be sure to sign our online guest book to mark your worship here with us today. After that, we have the opportunity to bring our offerings of thanks to our Heavenly Father. Please stand for prayer.
God, Heavenly Father, we praise you for pouring out your spiritual understanding and putting your words into the mouth of your prophet, Jeremiah. You came to him when he was confused and in doubt and had fear about the ministry before him. You came to him when he was timid and afraid, and you moved him to speak boldly about the great things that you had done. God, we too have felt uncertain and hesitant. Give us the courageous conviction of faith to speak to others about Jesus as you enabled Jeremiah and your disciples. Let us experience the joy of leading others to discover the way to heaven through faith in Jesus. Forgive us for the times that we have failed to speak of Jesus' love because we were afraid. Forgive us for not trusting in your power and for not relying on your word of truth to bring others to faith. Help us remember your promises, that you will always be with us, and that you will give us the words to say. Hear us, Lord, also as we bring you our private petitions in silent prayer.
Empower us to seize every opportunity to share the gospel of Jesus' love and salvation. Open the hearts of people everywhere so that many thousands will enter the kingdom of believers through the gospel. We ask all this in Jesus' name, who also taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Our God comes to us in a very special way as we participate in the Lord's Supper, and we surely do want everyone to enjoy this wonderful blessing. But before people participate and join with us in this Holy Communion, we ask that you speak with me prior to communing so you can join us at a later time. We continue with the preface found on page 12 in our worship folder. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is good and right so to do.
It is truly good and right that we should at all times and in all places give you thanks, O Lord. Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who came as the light of the world so that the world may have light and life through him. Therefore, with all the saints on earth and hosts of heaven, we praise your holy name and join their glorious song.
Holy, 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 sing, to the heavenly armies sing, for his glory, might, and worth, fill the heavens, fill the holy, 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 cry to the Lord of hosts most high. Hail, Hosanna, David's son, blessed is the one who comes. In the name of God the Lord, name of blessings rich outpoured. Hail, Hosanna, save us now, holy, holy God of power.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
O Lamb of God, who takes away the whole sin, now hear us pray. Have mercy on us, grant us peace from all our sins, give us release.
You may be seated, and the members may come forward at the direction of our ushers.
Take and eat. This is his body, which is given to you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and drink. This is his blood, which is given to you for the forgiveness of sins. May this body and blood strengthen and preserve you in the true faith until life everlasting. Go knowing your sins are forgiven. Amen.
given to God for you, for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given to God for you, for the forgiveness of all of your sins.
Given to you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and drink. True blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given to you for the forgiveness of all of your sins.
The blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given and shed on the cross for you, for the remission of all of your sins. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace, your sins are forgiven. Amen. Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for you, for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and eat. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given unto death for you, for the forgiveness of all of your sins.
Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given to you, for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given to you for the forgiveness of all of your sins.
This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given and shed on the cross for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given into death for you, for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take you this is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given into death for you, for the forgiveness of all your sins.
Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given to you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Depart in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. This is the true body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given into death for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Take and drink. This is the true blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ,
shed on the cross for you for the remission of all of your sins. Now may this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Go in peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Stand for the Song of Simeon.
In peace, Lord, you let your servants now depart according to your word, for my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared for every people. To light in the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.
Heavenly Father, with a star you led the wise men of old to worship the Christ child. Light the way through your word and sacrament that we too may see our Savior and worship him. Jesus Christ, light of the world, continue to burn brightly for our eyes of faith to see the forgiveness we have through your sacrifice and the home in heaven that you have won for us. Holy Spirit, continue to let our faith shine in everything we say and do so that others may come to know the love and the forgiveness that is theirs through faith in Jesus. We ask all this in our Savior's name.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for our closing hymn. Welcome to worship. Special welcome to our guests and visitors. We're so pleased to see you here this morning and glad you could be with us. We want to thank Eli Van Sice. Eli is a senior in high school at Michigan Lutheran Seminary, which is one of our church body's preparatory schools for public ministry. MLS has about 240 students, I believe, there, and about 430 students at Luther Preparatory School in Watertown, Wisconsin. Those two schools make up about half the pastors, produce about half the pastors in our church body. Eli is considering studying for the pastoral ministry where he would go to Martin Luther College in the fall. So thank you for joining us this weekend. He shadowed me this weekend and kind of got a taste of the ministry to see what it's like in the life of a pastor. Thanks for joining us. Thanks for helping out with the worship and Bible class today. And we'll certainly keep you in our prayers as you prayerfully consider doing this awesome work. And I hope you do. I wanted just to point out that on February 15th, our youth group is going to be offering up their babysitting services. So if you You want to take your wife out on a hot date? You want some good, reliable babysitters? You can drop the kiddies off here from 5:30 to 8:30, they'll be left in capable hands. Go out for dinner and come back up and scoop them up. Also, the Mingles group, the 20-somethings, 30-somethings group, they're going bowling next Sunday after church. So if you want to do that, you can talk to Ben Schaefer. Ben, you want to raise your hand? So talk to Ben, and he'll let you know, give you some more details about that. I wish you God's blessings this week, and look for those opportunities as he places people in your path to share the wonderful news of his love for the world. So look for those opportunities, and God will give you the courage to speak, and he'll give you the words to share. I'm going to let Eli usher you out, and I'll meet you in the back of the church. But have a great week, and we'll see you next week, if not before.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you very much. Good morning.
Hey, Eli.
How are you doing? Morning.
Thank you.